go to the police?
Call the police?
Yeah.
Tell them what?
Oh, I'll tell them what happened.
That's a good idea, Dale. Oh, hidey-ho, officer. We've had a doozy of a day. There we were, minding our own business. Just doing some chores around the house when kids started killing themselves all over my property.
Hey guys, welcome back to Spooky Tuesday, a weekly podcast where we're breaking down all of our favorite slashers, thrillers, monster movies, and black comedies on the new scariest day of the week. I'm Sydney Thompson.
I'm Monica Height.
I'm Chelsea Duff, and apparently TV doesn't make the list anymore. That's crazy.
It was a one and done.
It was a one time.
And here's the thing, it could come back when I'm in a silly, goofy TV mood again.
Sure. Yeah.
It's down to do TV.
Really up to Sydney's whims every single episode.
Yeah, who knows?
We're all watching School Spirits, so just saying, we're all.
If you're not, please watch it. Monica and I want a second season. Sydney hasn't watched enough to know she wants a second season yet, but she does also want it.
I cried at least three times.
Oh no, I'm only on the second episode, but I really liked it so far. So I'm in. It's really cute.
Yeah, and it has the girly from the much-hated 2022 Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Sarah Yarkin, who I went
and
to
Happy
school
Day
with.
And Happy Today 2, an iconic sequel.
And it has the Disney guy from Zombies.
One, two, and three. Very charming in it.
Here's the thing, he's charming in literally everything. I love him.
Also, weirdly, he's been in two things with people that I've gone to college with. So he was in Zombies 3 with Terry Hugh, and then he's in This with Sarah Yarkin.
Ooh. There you go.
Next, he'll be on Spooky Tuesday.
Anyway, yeah, next TV Spirits. Show.
They're not paying us. We just feel passion.
We're just a TV podcast now, okay?
We're just a TV podcast, except for right now when we're actually going to do a movie. But what movie is it?
What movie? It's so crazy.
So this week, we're going to do my least favorite thing to do, and that is take a trip to the woods.
I was like, what's this introduction?
And we're taking a trip to the woods with Tucker and Dale to go fucking fight some evil.
Gorgeous.
In Tucker and Dale versus Evil. Mm-hmm. This movie fucking slaps, and if you haven't seen it, please go watch it. It is so funny. It's so light, unlike The Exorcist, which we did last week.
And what we're doing next week, too, so you're lucky
we
for this one.
We needed a little fucking breather, yeah. A little break in between.
Let's come up for air.
Imagine watching a movie and feeling joy.
Can you believe?
A novel concept.
Can you imagine? Okay, so Tucker and Dale versus Evil is affable hillbillies Tucker and Dale are on vacation at their dilapidated mountain cabin when they are mistaken for murderers by a group of preppy college students. And sure, that's what this movie is about, but it's so much more than that.
So much more. Oh, man. This is like, it truly was a joy. I big smiled the whole time. I was having a bad week, and this made me feel better. I had ridden many miles on my bike, and it went really bad earlier in the day. And my soul was sad. And now my soul is so bright with the sun. Wow, amazing. How did you feel, Chelsea?
I loved it. I thought it was really fun. I thought I was like a little surprised after watching it that Sydney loves this one so much but hated Bodies, Bodies, Bodies. But it is a very different beast. So,
they're so different.
I get it.
Those are so different.
But you see the connection that I'm drawing, I'm sure.
No.
I don't.
It's all big misunderstanding.
That's not why I didn't like Bodies, Bodies, Bodies.
Whatever. Anyway.
Okay, so going with these broad subjects.
college students, lots in common. But also I was like, this is also a little Final Destination-y with some of these deaths, the series of events and how it's all coming together, which is interesting because there are two Final Destination 3 actors in this movie.
Oh my god, you're right. I was like, mm-hmm. I recognize this blonde girly. Where from? And then is it Chad? Is Chad the other one?
Yeah. He's Jason, the boyfriend on the roller coaster.
Oh my god. Wow. I love to see that.
The actor who plays Chad and the actor who plays Dale were in a couple episodes of Are You Afraid of the Dark?
Oh my God. There's so much going on here. Because also some of them were in Unreal. Some of them were in, oh, I guess the other one that I was looking at was Final Destination 3. But I feel like a lot of them have had like some overlap career-wise so far. And there's just so many recognizable faces in general.
I know. Oh my God. I keep getting confused because I watched this movie on Saturday and then last night I watched Cocaine Bear. And I was like, oh, the guy from Modern Family is in it. And that was Cocaine Bear. So that's my bad.
That was Cocaine Bear. Sure.
That was Cocaine
Bear.
Both
in the woods, you know.
It's confusing.
Both involving some unfortunate accidents and mishaps.
You know. I'm just so glad I finally actually seen this movie because I mentioned this at the end of last episode that I fell asleep when I watched this with Adam like 2 years ago and I thought like, oh, I fell asleep, and I woke up at some point and I saw part of it, right? Surely I was awake at the beginning, surely I would recognize anyone. No, I think I fell asleep when it was like whatever the production company was, what came onto the screen, immediate unconsciousness. I think I woke
the lights
up.
The went out and you seriously, also went out. Yeah.
I don't remember a goddamn thing because I had many thoughts at the very beginning of this movie and I was like, I would remember having thoughts. And then I think I woke up when he like puts on the welder's mask and then I was like, I recognize this. None of the rest of the movie. I woke
immediately
up for 1 second,
right back out.
Back to sleep immediately. Like, honestly, it's really great when you're conscious. It's so crazy.
That's so wild. Who would have guessed it'd be better to be awake?
I know. I always thought it'd be better to be asleep, but this
I
one
was,
time.
Like, so tired while I was watching this. And so I did pause it and take like a little cat nap just so that I would not fall asleep watching. And I did have a little dream about what might happen next in the movie, but it didn't go
right?
that way. So no, damn. It was like a little too paranormal, I guess. This is totally real, totally real events movie. So,
oh man, I really loved the beginning of this movie in particular. Okay, maybe not the first opening scene because I forgot the opening. You were just reminding me. It's like found
footage
kind of vibe, right?
Yeah.
Yes, it loops around. I wonder if it was like, I mean, we'll talk about it more maybe once we've talked all the way through, but I feel like that is kind of sequel bait a little bit, maybe, like, were they wanting to do a sequel? Because it's an interesting starter because it really sets the tone for what it wants you to think. But when you realize that it's like a looping back around situation, it's like, oh, there's some open threads here on this plot.
Because they're saying like, oh, like we're investigating these kids that have gone missing. Is that what it is? I literally blocked it out of my mind.
Yeah, it's hard to talk about the beginning without like revealing the whole
okay,
thing.
We can skip
but it's a spoiler podcast. But basically it's like a journalist and her cameraman going into a crime scene and they're like, we're going to report on it. Like, the police haven't cleared this crime scene yet, but surely there's something here that they missed that we can investigate. And then they get got by a sort of mystery assailant.
Oh, okay. So it's just a little openings, spooky scare.
You don't know what you're seeing until you've watched the whole movie.
Okay.
You're well, like, okay, what's this? And then at the end, you're like, that's that. Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You have to
totally.
Have a really
like,
good
just
memory.
Just like Crimson Peak, actually.
Exactly. Yeah, you
like
have to
it.
Have a really good memory to make the connection yourself. Because I watched this movie and then I went, wait, what was the beginning again? And then it was only when I rewatched the beginning that I was like, oh, interesting. Okay, now I see, like, not what storytelling purpose this is serving, but like in the plot, I see what plot this is finishing
out. What
the
heck was going on? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, fair. Wow. Well, the actual beginning of this movie, though, after that. Okay, my beginning.
After the cold open. Yeah.
After the cold open. I was getting the most Cabin Fever vibes from the beginning of this movie. It was like, so spot on. And then Cabin Fever, of course, was like paying homage to like Texas Chainsaw Massacre kind of vibes. So it's all part of that. But it was really, it felt really close to Cabin Fever, which like made me excited, probably made you guys upset, probably made you scared, Chelsea.
you didn't like that one. It didn't make me scared, but it is interesting that you mentioned that because Cabin Fever kind of has that same thing where they have the scene in the gas station in the beginning and they go, these people are scary. And then at the end, it's like, these people are making friends. So, yeah. You know, actually, it's really serving some great narrative parallels.
Yeah, totally. No, I think both of these movies are pretty similar because they're like, oh, these people out here. Can I say hillbillies? It says hillbillies in the thing. Yes. I mean, yes. These hillbillies are scary and they're bad and I don't understand them. But like in Cabin Fever, as we know, spoilers for Cabin Fever, it's like what kills all of the kids, their stupidity. That's what kills them. And then it's like similar thing here. Well, it's also flesh eating bacteria, but how do they get the flesh eating bacteria? They kill a man.
But even the gas station scene specifically, I mean, like in the beginning of Cabin Fever, they say like, oh, these are for black people, and they say it really scary, threatening, and you're like, oh my god, they're racist. And then at the end, they're like, here are my friend, the black people, here are your wares that you
ordered. Oh my god, I totally forgot about that.
It's so fucking funny. My favorite part at the beginning is when all the college kids are like, oh, we forgot the beer, and then they all scream.
When she pops up out of the trunk, oh my god. I had to ride the beer back of the trunk one time. It is stressful. I was worried the whole time we were gonna get rear-ended and I was gonna die. Don't do that.
There's a possibility.
It's always a possibility. I mean,
I one time in my Mini Cooper had me, another person riding shotgun, three people in my back seat, and my ex-boyfriend in the trunk of my Mini Cooper. And I was like, you're sitting back here because he was tripping on mushrooms and was being annoying. And I was like, you can go in the back. Goodbye.
Sure. Hide him. Hide him.
He also was like terrified of being in the trunk. It was a Mini Cooper. It was a very small trunk.
Oh my God. Yeah, it's a Mini Cooper. So he was like in the trunk.
But it's not like
a hostage situation.
What do Mini Coopers look like again? Let me do a Google.
They're like a little square.
It's like a regular. It's not like a Honda Civic trunk.
No.
Where you're like, you're a bot.
It's not like he had to like punch out the stoplight or something.
They pulled the emergency
light.
Yeah.
That would be really bad.
Stuffed her boyfriend on mushrooms in the trunk. Close it shut.
Honestly,
you're fine.
I would do that. That is absolutely something that 18-year-old me would have absolutely
fucking done. Ex-boyfriends shouldn't be having being annoying time if they don't want to go in the trunk.
That could literally break someone's mind, I think. If they're
don't do that. Yeah, don't do it. That sounds real scary.
They could have a mentee bee in there. But anyway, something I also took away from this movie is the fact that I want to try pickled eggs.
Oh, those are such a thing in the South. I have some in my pantry right now. I have regular eggs and quail eggs.
Oh. I would do a quail egg because littler. I mean, I would eat a full big regular pickled egg, but I don't want to have more than, you know, maybe two.
I don't eat them. They are for guests.
That big jar that he says it's like a 6-pound jar, and then you see it when he's eating them, and I feel like 30 eggs were already gone. He's hungry. Like protein bulk.
He was drinking a lot of beers while driving.
What do men call it? He wouldn't, because he's not one of the college boys. He's one of the woodsmen. They're macros. Gotta get their macros.
I don't know what that means, and I'm so glad. I'm so glad I'm not around people who bring that up.
Guys gotta get their macros for their keto diets, possibly. Well, those two might go together.
When I visited Sydney in the South, I had a wonderful time eating boiled peanuts. And so only imagine that pickled eggs would be just similarly delightful.
We like pickling things here in the South. Pickled cauliflower, pickled pig's feet. Oh, yeah.
Ooh, I've never had a pig's feet. I
won't eat those, but a lot of people do eat them. You can buy them in the stores.
Noted.
I'll consider it.
Filed away, yeah.
Another one of my favorite little scenes in the beginning is, you know, he sees her and he's like, I'm going to go talk to her. And Tucker is like, go do it. You can do this. But he's holding the sickle.
The scythe, yes. And they acknowledge that later when they're talking about that interaction and they're like, where did that go wrong? She could have been like, you were holding a weapon. That didn't
come
up, I guess.
Weapon.
Yeah.
But he's like, so you're going into the woods, and starts like scary laugh, or so you're going camping, and starts crazy laughing. And I would be like, we're turning around right now. This is the end. Like, we're going to die. This is an omen. Funny.
Tucker's like, if you are ever in doubt, just smile and laugh.
Yeah.
He's just really good, like, advice, hey guys,
maybe under completely different circumstances. Yeah. Didn't just, work like, out never for bring him a here. Safe.
What if that's how I started meeting people. I like show up with my big thing.
I think it could work for you,
smiling
though.
And laughing.
Yeah, I think for like a delightful, lovely nose ring bisexual lady, it's totally different vibe, you know?
Yeah, it's just quirky, but unfortunately,
she's quirky.
She's just one of those quirky little bisexuals. Yeah,
like quirky side girls. Oh my god, that's my friend Sydney. Sorry, she always brings us safe. So it's like her bear. She won't stop. I don't know. Yeah, she thinks she's like Grim Reaper.
To be out in the field. She's like having little picnics, cutting down tall grasses. You know how it goes.
Yeah. With her adorable giggle.
Gorgeous. Gorgeous.
Gorgina.
Wow. Yeah, see. But poor Dale. They judge him. Yeah. Also, okay, one unbelievable thing about this. Like, I get that, like, he's not what is a stereotypical hot guy. I think Dale is cute. Just look at his little cute face. He's so cute. I love him.
No, Dale's absolutely a cutie. And I also think Tucker is cute in, like, a redneck hillbilly way.
Tucker's also cute. He just is so sunburnt, you can't see what he looks like. So
and then he gets all the
it's hard to tell. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's hard when your face is covered in bee welts. Not good. But yeah, I don't know. I was watching this movie. I had such a good time, and I really liked reading about it too, because it's like all about like subverting toxic masculinity, and it's just like we love to see that every day, especially in 2010, which is when this movie came out. It was pretty exciting content. For 2010, we weren't that woke then. We were still in high school.
I mean, they do a lot of little gags that are very gay, like when they get pulled over by the cop in the beginning.
Oh yeah,
and they were drinking beers in the truck, so they're like trying to hide the evidence, but it looks like they were doing a little roadhead on the drive.
So funny.
They don't, like, they let that be the joke without being like, isn't it crazy that one man might suck another man's dick? Like, they don't, like, laugh at the idea of being gay. They're just like, isn't this a funny little scenario? Isn't this a funny little predicament? I thought it was cute.
Yeah. And they're such nice friends. Like, Tucker's always trying to gas Dale up and be like, you need to stand up for yourself. But okay, all these articles I read, which are linked in the references, are like, wow, they have such a great relationship and they're like so loving to each other all the time. I think Tucker's kind of mean to Dale still.
Oh, sure.
Yeah,
Tucker, like, all these articles are like, they're perfect,
but not to him. Yeah. But not to him. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then you've got a whole frog reveal later on, like,
that's besties.
Sometimes it is a little toxic bestie ship. Sometimes, you know,
sometimes
you
solve
it, you get it together. I feel like it's really exemplified in the moment where, skipping around here a little bit, but when Dale has Allison and they're playing board games and Tucker comes in with all of the bee stings and he's being real bitchy. But then Dale is like, would you like me to take the stingers out and help you? And then Tucker's just like, yeah, I would like that. And then they're nice to each other again. Like, he just is a little bit of a bitch. And I think, you know, that's okay. It's okay.
Sometimes you're just a little bit of a bitch. Sometimes,
well, and here's the thing, too. You know, he does get stung all over his face.
A lot.
By bees.
I'd be a little bitchy, too,
he
if
gets
I got
his
stung
fingers
all over by bees.
Cut off. He has to witness
his bowling
guy.
Fingers.
Yeah.
Not just any fingers.
His bowling fingers.
Those are the most important ones.
They truly are. My favorite little bit that's kind of like a running thing is like every bad thing that happens to him, he just pours beer on it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, which that's is so maybe accurate.
Does that work as a disinfectant the way that they use like vodka and whiskey in
movies?
No.
No. The alcohol content is so low.
And it's got yeast. 7%
in it. That like adds to the bacteria instead
cultures,
of taking it away. Yeah.
Okay. Well, not filing it away for future use then, but
some
love it for him. What a fun little character choice. Apparently it was a character choice that I don't know how to say his name. And when I was thinking of it earlier, I was like, wouldn't it be funny if it was Twadik? But it's not. I just don't know how to say it. Alan Tudyk, maybe. Yeah, I don't know. But he's like a well-known actor. He's like people like him. That was his idea, apparently, to pour the beer on his face after the bee stings. So I mean,
it has healing properties, but not in that distinct way.
goes inside, sure.
Oh my god. I also just love the whole concept that Tucker and Dale like have this vacation home and they're so excited. And they've always dreamed of having a vacation home and now they have a vacation home. Like, that's a big deal. Property ownership ain't easy.
Like a super almost crumbling, falling down cabin in the woods.
Yeah, vacation immediately. Yeah.
Oh my god. Well, okay, the cabin itself was giving Evil Dead. When they walked in and it had, like, all of the, like, clippings up
the
and stuff.
Or whatever.
Yeah, I really thought it was gonna, like, become, like, a real Evil Dead homage. I'm glad that it didn't. I'm glad that it was what it was. But as someone who was asleep the first time, it could have gone anywhere for me.
Sure. I do think it loops back around to another point in the story. That I'm going to touch on but not fully get into just yet, which is back to the college kids. They're also doing their own little vacation in the woods. They're so excited. I don't know where maybe they were just camping, I guess, although they didn't seem prepared really to do that. Okay.
You see it like later. I can't remember just for a second.
Okay. But yeah, they're out in the woods. They're having a great time. Chad decides that they're going to do a little scary. Well, somebody else decides, actually. One of the other guys who's there for 5 seconds decides they're going to do a scary story. And then Chad jumps on and goes, actually, mine is the scariest. This is real. There was a massacre here 20-ish years ago. And it was really scary, and it happened right here, right in this spot, right here. Anyway, should we go skinny dipping? And, you know, I think it is such a choice to be like, actually, we picked this spot on purpose, and I think it's for fun. I mean, like, obviously he has motivations that we'll get into. But I thought he was just making it up for a little spooky, scary moment, you know? But it turns out he loves to research, maybe.
Well, he, like, gives off this vibe that he's full of shit, and, like, he is, but not necessarily at that moment. Like, he was telling the truth, but he just seemed like he was trying to piss off all of his friends and made them terrified, which he also did that. So, you know, successful on many fronts. He's got such a punchable face. God.
And his name's Chad.
They did that on purpose. They literally have him, like, color popped the whole movie. And that turquoise
blue was so prevalent in 2010.
His total prep. It's interesting. I mean, this movie has a commentary on toxic masculinity. It's also a commentary on, like, you know, like, oh my God, I can't remember words. Socioeconomic inequalities, blah, 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 blah. Yeah. He's like this, like, little pretty rich boy. There we go. What's the word for socioeconomic inequalities? But yeah, he's classism. Like this little fucking prep. Classism is another word for it, which has less words in it, which I like.
I like yours though. It sounds so smart.
Oh, thank you so much. Wow.
All about the big words.
Big quarter words.
Quarter words, baby.
But yeah, no, I mean, like, he's such, like, a stereotypical prep, and he says, like, weird, like, fucking elitist classist shit, like, all the time. Like, he gets Allison alone, and he's like, we're different from the rest. We're, like, oh, God. Like,
oh, that was
and in the car, he's like, Omega Beta or die, bitch. Like, he has his whole, he literally is doing the frat thing.
You're literal, what is it? You're a literal, you're either literal. You're either Omega Beta or you're a freak.
So true, so true. We are all unfortunately freaks here.
Freak till I die, baby.
I love to be a freak.
You know, what are you gonna do?
Freak till I die, baby. Not rushing
fraternity.
I am technically in a fraternity. I am a frat bitch, as he gets called in the film, but that's a story for another day.
I thought you
fraternity for women. I forgot that the word didn't even exist yet. Yeah, I mean it's easy to forget.
I know it was like a huge deal. You were talking about it a lot of the time, not like too much, don't worry.
I like, actually like I don't know too much.
Don't mention it ever again, especially not on the Claire Clap from Outer Space episode, or Sydney will twist my words into unfortunate little admissions to the public.
Here's the thing. We all love a good cream pie fundraiser, Chelsea.
You know, it raises a lot of funds for important causes.
Exactly.
For literacy, you guys.
Maybe I should do a cream pie fundraiser for the AIDS life cycle. Do you think I should do that?
That would actually
for the AIDS life cycle. I'm doing a cream pie
fundraiser. I'm also doing a cream pie fundraiser, but it's just going to be me starting
it. That one's just for personal use. Yeah. It is a fundraiser for my personal funds.
Oh, man. I don't know what media I consumed in high school, though, where I was, like, graduated, and I was like, I'm never gonna do Greek life immediately. Like, I was just, like, so scandalized by the concept. I did not watch that.
Family? Oh.
I did not watch that. I don't know. I bet Sydney watched that. I was a hater. I was really? Born and bred.
I didn't watch it either. I just feel like Sydney would, maybe.
No, I don't know. Lived in the South where every day, even in high school, it was like that. So didn't need to watch it.
Sure.
Lived it.
So
I mean, and you also joined a sorority for a minute, so
and then immediately was like, no, thank you.
No thanks. Yeah, sure.
Like, eject. I know I've got the look, but that's not it.
Actually, the vibes were not right.
When I graduated high school, I did not have the look. I mean, I was like platinum blonde. I had my tongue pierced. I was like all
you
over
were
the place.
Their alternative girl diversity pick.
Yeah, I was actually like,
she's got a tongue piercing. That's different.
So and I was coming from Chicago, so that's the diversity city girl. Pick.
Oh my god, crazy! Like,
all of you are lame. Goodbye.
Sad for them.
The t-shirt slap though, still have so many t-shirts.
And you'll have those till you die.
That's until I die.
Well, with the actual movie though, you know, we could
sure. Back on track.
And the movie.
I would want to go skinny dipping. That's why I would die in any of these movies. I would love to go skinny dipping.
I'll go skinny dipping.
None of them died skinny dipping, though.
Perfectly I know, but activity, they mostly. Thought that somebody died skinny dipping, you know? And so, you know, people have died skinny dipping in a lot of these types of movies.
Sure.
We just have to make sure that we're not skinny dipping in, like, a place with, like, flesh-eating bacteria or leeches. Lots of rocks. Mm-hmm. Oh, leeches. I'd hate that.
My first thought
leeches,
was leeches.
I feel like, yeah, for sure that would be one of the worst, I think.
One of the reasons why I don't like camping is I got a tick up my vagina one time. And
what? Yeah, up it?
Up
sorry
it. My
if
mommy,
I broke your ears.
My mommy had to get it out. And I'm not.
This is the worst thing I've ever heard. I gotta go.
I'm not. Like, you know me. I'm very anti-camping.
That's why she doesn't go to the woods.
Yeah. Tick.
That's what happened to you in the woods. That was traumatizing.
Yeah.
Well, why haven't you told me this? I've been judging you for years. And now I understand your origin story.
I was like, I'm not going to tell you, but I'm going to tell you and all of our listeners.
And everybody. Yeah. And anybody who might
thank you, listeners, for
that,
being
honestly,
here to try to finally
out.
Tell me
I'm like,
this.
I can't have a one-on-one intimate like thing, but broadcasting it to a bunch of people,
it
sure, why not?
It makes it more casual, more easy breezy.
I get that.
It's a funny little
that.
Anecdote now instead of a true trauma.
It was so traumatic.
Well, yeah. A lot of things can happen in the woods, and apparently that's one of them.
I didn't know that. I didn't know that was a possibility. Is going to rethink the woods.
New fear unlocked.
And now you know why listeners. I'm like so anti.
Were
like,
you skinny dipping?
I was peeing.
That's I have a little story that I'll tell you later, but I'm not going to tell it to you now because I'm not on the record. Not on the record. Yet.
We're all in relationships. It's fine.
You know, I've told them a lot, but they don't need to know this. Okay. Anyway. But yeah, I mean, I would also go skinny dipping in the water, no question, but I would never climb. I would not climb and jump off of a rock in the night.
At night.
It's nighttime. Rocks are slippery. Notoriously, they're already slippery. Notoriously, they're even more slippery when they're covered in water and moss and all that shit. Mm-hmm. And that was just a bad decision on Allison's part. But we do love her nonetheless. She is a beautiful queen who was on 30 Rock.
We love her.
Katrina Bowden. She's so beautiful.
Seriously.
Like an angel. But it's ridiculous how stupid these kids are, because they're already scared. Like, it not in no way does it look like Tucker and Dale are eating Allison. In no way does it look like that at all. But they're like, it was hard to see, but it looked like they were eating her face off. How many Bud Lights had you had, bud?
Well, they'd also just heard a little spooky, scary massacre story about hillbillies
but
in the
no
woods.
Cannibalism,
they were primed.
Though.
Sure. They let their imagination run away with them on that one. They've been watching too much Yellow Jackets.
I would like to hope. Okay, no spoilers, because I went to the premiere, as y'all saw, and then I haven't watched a single episode.
Oh my God.
I'm waiting for more episodes.
I'm working on it.
I want to binge.
Take your time.
I'm waiting for James to give me the time of day, okay? So we can all watch it as a family.
Valid.
But, yeah, I don't know. I love that this movie is technically, I would say, in the rom-com genre. It is also a romantic comedy. And
so true.
I was very moved by the little sweet romance between Dale and Allison that we get. I really loved it.
It was so sweet.
It was so sweet. I mean, he's just like a really genuinely good guy. He's just like really, really nice. He's not like some guy who's like, there's a line between. Well, okay. The again thing was actually something we were talking about before we recorded, I realized. For the first time, there is a fine line. There is a fine line between like the like nice guy, like trope or whatever, like, oh, he's such a nice guy, and incel, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And Dale is firmly a nice guy.
Yes.
Not an
incel.
That's because
here's part of the difference. He does not resent people for not being interested in him. He just is like, people aren't interested in me, and that's a shame.
Exactly. And he doesn't feel like, I think another thing is like the misogyny.
Anger.
Of it, and then it's just like, I am owed women's affection.
Fuck these bitches who don't like me. Yeah, that's not his vibe.
Yeah, it's just like, women are here to fuck me. What the fuck that they don't want to? That's part of the incel thing. Mm-hmm. Dale ain't like that. Dale, a good boy.
He's
sweet
such
boy.
A
He's
good
just
boy.
Like, I'm just Dale, not very likable.
Like
not true.
Well, let me go in and make eggs and bacon.
Dale's actually the perfect example of, like, I always say, I don't want a nice guy. I want a good man. And Dale a good man. Like,
that is
exactly, like, that's how you would, like, Chad wants to say he's, like, a nice guy, right? Know what I mean? He's not. But I bet you if you asked him, he would describe himself as a nice guy. And Dale is a good man. And that's what you want, ladies.
Mm-hmm. Chad has been absolutely waiting for any opportunity to go batshit psycho, do some murders.
Yes. Oh yeah, 100%. You heard him tell that story. You're like, oh, he's just doing little antics. No, he isn't. He's
laying groundwork.
He put this whole thing together so he could kill somebody. Like, that's what this Memorial Day trip is about.
When he took them here because he was just hoping some crazy hillbilly would try.
When we say, you know, it's white men, Chad is prime example number one.
Chad is the white man.
Yeah. That we should all be scared of.
Yep. Terrifying. That's Swoopy Hair. Mm-mm. We know better now. We're not, it's not 2010 anymore. Okay.
God, that hair was such a vibe.
It was such a vibe in 2010. Oh, I wonder. Oh, God. I don't think I would have thought he was cute if I saw this when it came out. Would I have? Oh, I really hope not. We'll never know.
We probably would. Because that's.
We'll never know.
That's was supposed to be the peak ideal male.
I thought he was cute.
The ultimate Chad.
I thought he was cute in Final Destination 3. So that doesn't go well. Jesse Moss, you're a fine looking gentleman.
His vibes were different.
Yeah, that's true. He did a great job. He's an incredible actor with doing subtle facial work to look like a dick bag in this one.
Vibes are so important. They really contribute a lot.
They really do. They really do.
Incredibly passionate about vibes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm incredibly passionate about how Dale is so good at trivia, and he was so excited about it. He's got an amazing memory. He's a genius. He's actually a genius, is the thing.
Yeah, which is so funny. He's just like a cute little soft boy.
And he knows everything that he's ever heard before, which is actually terrifying. It's actually anything I'd say to him, he would be able to like be like, I remember when
you said
this.
Oh my god, you would never be able to gaslight
so much shit.
You would never be able to gaslight him.
Yeah.
Well, no. But he's not confident either. So I think you probably, not that you shouldn't, but I think you probably could.
But you could probably pull that guy over, yeah.
Tucker's doing it all the time. Tucker definitely is gaslighting him sometimes, so.
Yeah, no, totally. Oh, poor manipulatable Dale. He's a sweetie, though.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, Allison is a great character too, because you know you look at her when you first see her, she's giving like sorry I'm gonna say nice things after sorority bimbo a little bit okay, just because she's hot and she's blonde and I'm sorry Sydney, I love you. But Sydney's just like Sydney, there's more to her.
It's okay if you look at my Instagram bio, it does says bimbo intellectual, and I live by that, actually. Bimbo intellectual, comma, podcast host.
There you go. Beautiful.
Those are the words to live by. But yeah, I mean, it's quickly revealed, like, she looks like she's gonna fit into this mold with Chad. I hate saying his name. And I know Chad's in real life who suck too. It's just like, it's true. I'm sorry. Anyway, we're moving back onto the movie.
I know a bunch of Chads that are actually very lovely in real life, and it makes me dislike them because they're so lovely. And I'm like,
change your name. But yeah, as revealed, Allison, you know, has a heart of gold. She wants to be a therapist, so she's got emotional depth. And she grew up on a farm, so she's not afraid of hard work or whatever and digging out a latrine.
Digging her own grave. She ain't scared.
She ain't scared of digging her own grave. But I think this movie's really brilliant in like the way that it's so funny and it's so lighthearted, but the deaths are pretty fucking gruesome. And they're just so fucking stupid. They're so stupid. Like, that first guy to go, I mean, it's so funny. I, too, would be terrified if I saw a man running, screaming with a chainsaw above his head. But poor Tucker he really sawed right into that beehive. That is probably a worst nightmare scenario. But you wouldn't see me with a chainsaw at any time, so it could never be me.
You'd think he would put it down just because running with a chainsaw, I would imagine, much like running with scissors, is not advisable. Yes. But he sure just keeps bringing it, waving it all around as he goes.
I think he was trying, because they were like swarming his face still, and he was trying to like saw
each individual little bee.
Saw each individual bee in half. It's not fine tooth enough for that.
And it's a reference to Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Yeah. Yes. Gorgeous, gorgeous homage.
Gorgina
homage.
Jesus Christ. But that first death is so funny too, because like the guy is running and running and he's terrified. What was his name?
Marshall?
Mitch.
Mitchell.
I was like, there's an O somewhere in the name tag on his little t-shirt.
Ah, yes. Well, little Mitch, he's being a little bitch. He's running around.
Mitch the bitch.
And he thinks that he's being Chainsaw Massacred to death, which you might imagine. I would think the same thing. But then he just impales himself onto a long pointy stick. And trees do be like that sometimes. So be careful when you're running in the woods. But as he dies, he looks at Tucker and sees the bees. And he's like, oh. And he realizes in his death moment that he wasn't trying to get him. And then he just dies right then. Like, those little things are so funny. Some of them really died thinking that they were in some type of shit. But Mitch had clarity at the end. He was like, well, I did this to me.
I did this to myself, unfortunately.
Yeah. I mean, he has that moment where he's, like, watching Tucker pass him and not, like, loop back around. And he's like, wait, you're clearly not chasing after me. What's going on again? But it was just too late on that one. The momentum had already been momentum. Do you know? There was no
slowing that pace down.
Yeah.
He was already impaled. Or he was about to be. But
you have two impalements in this movie, which is crazy. Almost a third, but thank God Dale's not hung like a bear.
Thank God.
Thank God. Thank God. We don't want that anyway. Too big. But I just... When they start to realize what's happening, like, that, imagine thinking, though, Tucker and Dale, that there's this horde of crazy kids and they're in a suicide pack and they've come to your property to just, like, all die. It's so fucking funny and terrible at the same time. Like, poor Dale is so horrified because this guy impales himself on the pole and just bleeds out on top of him. That's so scary. And the wood
that chipper, chipper is my favorite scene in this entire movie because he literally fucking swan dives into it and then they're trying to pull him out.
Yeah, but then you see the other guys looking over and they're like holding the legs, being like, with him still actively, his blood squirting out of the other end of the wood chipper. I mean, you can understand where the miscommunication comes in.
Yeah. I mean, you can. It's like, it's believable up until a point, and then, like, I don't know. The cop part gets really hairy too. That cop was interesting too, because there's a blink and you, like, miss it kind of thing at the end where you realize, like, he was the cop at the original massacre. Which we'll get into more later, but he's also the cop from the very beginning, and he knows that, like, he knows that this property is cursed, and, like, the way he's behaving with Tucker and Dale, like, if he didn't, like, you'd think he'd be, like, you know, guns drawn at the very least, you know, but I feel like he kind of is like, no, this is a cursed land or something. I don't know. His behavior was kind of weird, but I thought he might, like, be nice to Tucker and Dale, but he didn't even have a chance.
Yeah. I mean, that was part of the. I mean, some of the miscommunications are 100% on the college kids for being stupid. But they think they have finally gotten the police to come help them. They've gotten back to Tucker and Dale's cabin. The police are going inside to investigate, even though the college kids are, like, trapped in the back of the car and being like, don't go in there, don't do it. But, like, the guy goes in, as soon as he was about to lean against the beam, I was like, oh no, I know where this is going. And then just the part of the beam fell on him with nails in it, got nails in his whole face. He was down for the count. He stumbles back outside. You know, it's, they don't know, the college kids don't know that this house is dilapidated and has been on the market for 20 years, falling apart the whole time. They think that the police has been further smashed in the face. They think attacks back on. I mean, it's rough. It's rough out here. Every time they're like, well, just tell the truth. I was like, the truth is honestly so unbelievable that I can't even believe hardly that, like, anyone believes it at the end.
Well, there's no one to say it didn't happen.
I mean, I guess who knows the police in that area, but I still feel like they would be like, well, I guess those news reporters were like, there must be more to it. So clearly there was some doubt. But interesting, interesting.
Travis die? He's the one who goes and gets the cops.
He shoots himself.
Ethan?
Oh, I'm sorry. His actor name is Travis. His name is Chuck. I'm so sorry. Do apologize.
Shoots himself in the face?
Yeah, that's him. He shoots himself in the face.
And they're like, the safety. Stupid. Be like, you still have the safety on. And he's like, boink.
But they literally say, like, don't do that. Don't put it towards your face. And he still does it.
That one was 100% on him. And that's the one that's really fucked up where the college kids are like, oh my God, he's dead. Like, yeah, you literally just saw him do that to himself. That one's his bad.
It's 100% his bad. It's, oh, man. This movie gets so frustrating, though. Just like, well, I'm skipping a lot. But I don't know. Even when faced with the truth, these kids just don't want to actually accept it at all. But we're not there yet. I'm sorry.
Well, it was funny, though, when they have the like tea sit down conversation. And that one girl's like, she's got Stockholm syndrome.
Oh, my God. That was so funny.
You can't get Stockholm syndrome from one day. Jesus Christ.
I don't know how much attention she was paying in her sociology class, to be fair.
That's a classic, like, I just took a class on this, so I'm an expert. Like,
oh my God, I heard about this one time. Yeah.
Oh my God, so frustrating. But, I mean, you know that Chad is a sociopath, psychopath, whatever you want to call him, a murderous asshole when he steals the dog.
Oh. Yeah!
The dog is so cute.
Jangers.
Jangers.
What's the deal? Does anybody know what that name's about? Jangers?
No.
It just sounds kind of fun to say. And true. Weird.
True.
Jangers is so cute. Another representation of the whole like thesis of the movie. He looks like he's a scary motherfucker, but he's actually a little sweetie peaty pie. Jangers
the
dog.
He's a sweetie peaty pie. That's so true.
Got beautiful blue eyes.
A little scary. You know that meme where someone had the dog on TikTok or whatever and somebody was like, I'm so scared, please buy him brown contacts. Like, that is a little bit Jangers vibes.
Fair, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But again, he's a good boy. But, like, anybody who's like, I'm gonna kill this dog if you don't... I mean, I guess...
He's trying to save his girlfriend.
Yeah, but also she doesn't like him and he needs to get over it. And I really feel like her quote unquote kidnapping, he saw as his opportunity to be like, actually, I'm going to be her hero and then she'll have to date me.
Right.
He's so sick. He's so sick.
Yeah, but he's going immediately like, these people are evil. These people are the picture of evil. Like, they kidnapped Tucker and they, like, hang him upside down and they're like, this is what evil smells like. It stinks. Like, he is just being so rude at every occasion.
He's being really self-righteous.
They're
and
just
I don't
wrong.
Like it.
It does wrong. Make you a little bit think about all of the quote-unquote good guy behavior you see in other movies where you're like, yeah, like, even if they're actually doing something super fucked up, because we have the benefit of knowing from the beginning in this movie that it's all a misunderstanding. But imagine if we didn't, you know, what would we possibly be rooting for?
Well, apparently
not the torture of people. I don't like to torture anyone,
but you probably would be like, yeah, call him stinky.
Okay, well, I mean, like, there I thought I was gonna hurt him too bad, but I hurt his feelings, but
that's an inside wound, okay?
I've had a long day. I was in my many bees. What are you gonna say, Sydney?
I read somewhere that they had a bonus thing on the DVD or something when this came out.
Ooh.
And it's the movie, or like, they did it but it couldn't get released or something, and it was the movie from the college kid's point of view.
No way.
Yeah. And I was like, I would love to watch that, actually.
That shitty ass horror movie.
Like, release that right now. Because it's probably more like a bad horror movie and like a horror comedy. Yeah. Like, that would be such a good, like, tandem release. Release this right now, you cowards.
I am curious. Like, I wonder if it rewrites anything or if it just gives us the, on IMDb trivia, it said it gives us the movie from the college kids' perspective, which would obviously imply that like nothing has actually changed. It's just what information the audience has access to. But it says it portrays them as murderous villains. So I'm like, I wonder if just, I wonder how it goes, you know? Be so curious.
Maybe from the angle that like, guy was watching her be pulled into the boat, it really looked like her face was getting munched by Tucker and Dale.
But also, literally, when they're like, we have your friend, and they're like, we should write them a note so they know. And then it's like, dun, dun, dun.
The fact that they're all literally right there watching the note get written, seeing like the tude that is imbued into that action. And I mean, it is still a very threatening looking note when you see it carved into a log.
Yeah.
We got your friend.
We got your friend.
Sure. I can see how there were misunderstandings. And everybody else was kind of like, this is bad. We need to save our friends. But they weren't necessarily trying to go full murder everybody the way that Chad was. He kind of was alone in that, thank God.
I feel like his whole life he's been looking for a reason. He was like,
oh yeah, just one reason.
One time. Look at me the wrong way for a little bit too long on the anniversary of my mother's death.
Yeah, he reveals his backstory in the tea scene. Where he says, actually, that massacre I mentioned earlier, that happened to me by proxy because that was my mommy. And his daddy, and his dad's body was never found, and his mom has had to be taken care of in an institution since practically before he was born, and he's been raised by his grandma this whole time. So actually, he's not like a regular privileged frat boy. He's got layers.
He's got childhood trauma.
Even before the additional reveal, that mini reveal does prime you for like why he's so bloodthirsty, in the sense that he's like, I've known since the day I was old enough to know anything that there are people out there who want to hurt you and they won't hold back, and the only way you can escape is by being equally vicious. So like, he's been in training for this psychologically his whole life, for sure.
Absolutely. Oh god, that scene is so funny.
It is really funny.
Last showdown is so good. I mean, she's trying so hard to therapize them. I'm like, okay, honey, maybe this isn't the time.
Now, darling.
Not now, but it's a very sweet thought. But like, I love that Dale's like, here's this like horrifying story, and he's like, well, I'm so sorry that happened to your family to start.
It's so good.
It's so good. And then, like, just the chaos when the last of them all fucking die in that last little bit. It's just, it's so, so, so good. Like, he comes in with the one, what's his name? Oh, I'm going to look up characters' names. Jason.
You really don't get a lot of their personnel. Like, most of them kind of just don't really have one, and that's okay. It's not their movie. It's not college kids versus evil.
Yes. Well, Jason and Chloe are outside, and Naomi and Chad are inside, in case you want to know their names. and Jason and Chloe are like, oh my god, we have to go in there. It's been longer than 15 minutes. So Jason comes in, guns blazing, and by that I mean weed whackers blazing, and so just rips off Naomi's face, just like takes her face off immediately, because and he's like, why didn't she duck? She didn't know that there's gonna be a weed whacker face scenario going on. It's just, oh my god, it's so funny. And like, just watching everyone burn to death too, really, really good. Did Chloe burn to death as well?
I think
what
it's
happens
implied
to Chloe.
Yeah, yeah, they like
It's just Chad like threw the Final lantern. Destination.
Yeah. Oh, she always goes that way. Sad. She
always goes up in flames. Poor girly.
Yeah, but Chad throws the lantern. Chad previously threw gas all over the cabin. The writing was on the wall on that one.
Yeah, no, seriously.
Jason, apparently, his name was. Really not good at following the stop, drop, and roll instructions. But again, given the gasoline that had been thrown around, don't know that it would have changed anything anyway.
Yeah. Sorry, Jason.
Sorry, Jason, on that one. Bad luck, Jason.
Bad luck. And then, of course, fucking Chad can never die. But I do really like the makeup that they did on Chad after he got, like, half burned. He has got like
and his hair goes cool, crazy, like
mohawk thing going on, burn face, one ear, love it. It looked cool. I liked that a lot. But I really thought Tucker was gonna die because he got like stabbed in his tum tums, and that's always a bad place to get stabbed. I've noticed from films, a lot of stuff you can hit, a lot of bad stuff you can hit in there. So he's a lucky guy. But you know, when you're a nice person. You get saved.
You don't die.
Okay, this was the part though. Tucker, like, are you the reason that Dale has self-esteem issues? Like, you were like, yeah, I'll catch more frogs. So, what was it? Like, I'll catch more so you.
Oh, won't... I let you catch more frogs than me so you wouldn't feel bad. I always said I was letting you catch more.
So he's just like primed him from the start to think he's not very good at stuff, which but like I'm sure there are other influences in his life that did that as well. It couldn't have just been Tucker unless Tucker controlled Dale completely, but
he primed him to think he had such a nice, generous friend who always wanted him to feel good about himself. Just kidding. That's the gaslighting.
Yeah.
That's the gaslighting we mentioned earlier. Do you remember when we mentioned it? This was actually it.
Gaslight, yeah. Gatekey, bestie.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, okay, then we get the part where I briefly woke up when I watched it for the first time and I just saw Dale put the mask on and get the chainsaw and I was like, whoa, and then I was like, much better. I recognize this part and then it continued on and I was like, oh, I don't recognize it anymore. I was like, wow, I really was awake for 2 seconds. I fell back asleep. But this final showdown is so good. You like how classic, like cartoon villain of Chad,
yeah,
to like put her on the chainsaw thing. It's like tying her to the fucking train tracks.
He might as well have had a little mustache that he was twirling fully.
Yeah, seriously. And he had like, he went full super villain. Like he was on the intercom or whatever, talking shit. Like he fully like, I mean, if you're gonna go villain, you might as well do the whole shtick. And he got
you're
the crazy
gonna
hair.
Do it. Yeah.
Yeah.
You gotta commit to the bit.
I wish that he wasn't like so rapey, probably, yeah, is the word that I'm looking for. He's disgusting.
I think.
He is disgusting.
Doing a lot of non-consensual kissing.
Yeah.
Blech.
It's just he's bad. He sucks so bad. Oh god. But then we get the reveal that the true, well, not yet, before we get the reveal of the true truth of the matter, we get the sickest shit ever where Dale gets to be a superhero when he throws the fucking chainsaw and it like perfectly cuts all of the ropes. I was like, this is some John Wick shit right now. This is amazing.
He is better than he thinks. He does have hidden skills and talents.
He can do it.
Look at his amazing hand-eye coordination, knife skills in a way. Incredible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I don't love the reveal from the end, though. When they go upstairs and they find the final newspaper clipping. Like, I feel like that little bit undercut their
thing. Sure. But we do get the line where she goes, "You're half hillbilly, Chad."
That's true.
I'm sorry.
The drama of it, the silliness of it. That's true. That's great.
Like it's, I don't care. It can undercut everything for that one line.
Sure.
You're half hillbilly, sure. Chad.
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. They're saying like you're half hillbilly. you've got this in your blood all along. Like, I think a little bit they're being like, actually the hillbilly part of it is not related at all, other than we're communicating to him in a fast manner what's going on. We have to say something attention grabbing to make him pause and consider, you know?
Yeah.
They don't have time for nuance. They don't have time to parse nuance. That bit still, it's like kind of a fun reveal, still kind of sucks to me a little bit. I wish he was full cray, like, you know?
There's more like scary rape shit happening, you know, that we didn't
mean.
It's just like, oh, like it was a beautiful love child and the dad burned in a fire because he was murdered. No, it was like
wrong,
bad. I don't even want to say, you know, you figure it out.
Yeah, they're like, you are the product of this horrible thing, and you're not just like a side note in this horrible thing. And that's why you're terrible, which is what I don't love about it.
I don't think it would also like inspire him in that moment to become good and be like, look, we're the same, you know, we're all hillbillies.
I'm hillbilly, just like you.
I've just realized like a whole nother layer of trauma that like my whole existence was created through a trauma event.
Yeah.
How amazing. I love that for me. No one would want to hear that.
Yeah.
No one ever.
Yeah. Just a little grim in that bit, you know, didn't love that bit.
How does he die?
Well,
does
he? That's the thing. But I mean, He's got a lot going on in general with his grandma telling him
the
story from the beginning. That's what the beginning is. Yes, okay, because they've got the final showdown.
I didn't get that.
He like
until now
throws the chamomile dust in his face because earlier on, he'd been like, allergy. I can't have chamomile tea. It upsets my asthma. And what's her name? Allison is like, what'd you do to him? And Dale was like, oh, he'll be fine as long as he has his inhaler. But then he falls out the window. And it's just like, oh, man, he's dead. And they call the cops and the news reporters come, blah, blah, blah. But then if you rewatch the beginning, you'll see that, and I checked, the news reporter lady is wearing a different outfit than she is at the end. And they're doing, like, night vision. So, like, they've come back later.
Oh, yeah.
After everything has, like, calmed down. And they are investigating the inside and then, and it's him, and you can see once you know what he looks like at the end of the film, you go, oh yeah, that's him with the whole burned face coming out. Why is he still there after the police have come and gone? I don't know. Did he disappear in the beginning and they kind of just glossed over that at the end of the movie with the cops there? Must have.
They say, I remember in the end, they say like, oh, the body of the killer has not been found.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, well then I guess we knew that he didn't die anyway.
Or, yeah, I was like, either he didn't die or, like, he was all burnt. Oh, I don't know. I can't remember
the
how he died again.
Him whole. I mean, I guess I missed that part, but he must have gotten up and wandered off, and then he goes, actually, circle back around. Back to the beginning of the film, the cyclical nature of a story. The story that he told begets his story, which begins the story of this whole thing. So, time flat circle.
That was so beautiful.
Thank you.
It's actually really deep. This movie.
It's actually super deep. Yeah.
But then
they go bowling. Yeah, I mean,
honestly,
that part aside, Dale.
That's
and
the best part. We
Allie
love bowling.
Cute.
They go bowling and all right, well, wait, they go bowling, it's cute, she kisses him and it's amazing and we love that, but there's that
she
other
gets a
guy
helmet.
She gets a helmet. That was very cute. All this cute stuff happening in the background. Dale has just told this other hillbilly guy. This part pissed me off. I was like, I was having such a good time, and then we had to do this. Of course, great. He told this other hillbilly guy, he's like, oh yeah, you should go like ask for what you want because otherwise you'll never get it, blah, blah, blah. And he goes over and he hits a woman over the head and drags her body out of the bowling alley while they're making out.
Is that what happened?
Yes.
I assumed it was some other sort of accident, some series of accidents that was going on in the background. Because yeah. then Allie and Dale were like, should we help? And Dale was like, no. And to me, I was like, Dale has learned that sometimes when you intervene, when people are having an accident, bad things happen. Also, sometimes you get a girlfriend, but he's already got a girlfriend, so he doesn't need another one. So he's just not getting involved. He hit her?
I'm pretty sure he hit her. That's what I was like, did he just hit her? And Adam was like, yeah. And I was like, oh my God.
I thought it was an accident.
If I'm wrong, then I'm sorry. But if he said, like, he says to her, like, he says to him, go get what you want, and he bops her over the head and he gets what he wants and is dragging her out. He's not like trying to help her, he's like drag, he's not asking for help, he's smiling and he's dragging her out. If I'm wrong, then I'm sorry, I have a sick mind, but I'm 99% sure that's what it was. And I was like, I wish that that part didn't exist.
I'm gonna go with Chelsea and I's interpretation. I like it better. It makes me feel better.
It does look like he hits her, but it also looks like it's some kind of accident, so I don't know what's happening. Like, you see sort of like a backhanded motion, but then he looks so surprised that I'm like, okay, it's clear something went wrong. Wasn't supposed to play out that way.
Only, let's leave it to the listeners. Comment below. If you think...
Oh, do it as one of those polls on Spotify that you can do
on
now.
On Spotify, there are polls now. And right now, it's automatically set to, what did you think of the episode? And one person said nice things. Amazing. So you could say nice things. Or I'll do an actual poll this time. Be like, was that guy a scary person? Or was it a comedy of errors? Haha, I'll phrase it better. Comment below. Chelsea's still really trying to figure it out. Well, just Google it.
I'll wait to see what people tell me, I guess. Actually, that's a good idea. What happens in the bowling scene? Tucker, ampersand, Dale versus Evil. BJ was his name.
Oh, BJ.
It says on Wikipedia, accidentally knocks out a girl in the background, starting a new misunderstanding. So I choose to buy into the accident narrative.
Okay, well, I hope that that's the truth, because I was like, this is kind of dark ending. It just looks too jazzed. I don't know.
Sure. Anyway, look, sometimes misunderstandings lead to love. Like, sure, did all of Allison's friends die? Yeah. Did she get held and tied to a plank and was, like, run towards a table circular
saw?
That's yeah. But actually, she's fine because she's got a sweet little boyfriend now. So,
yeah.
That's how it works. You would get a boyfriend and your life is fixed.
Love is crazy sometimes. Beautiful. Anyway.
Did either of you guys ever watch Crazy Ex-Girlfriend? Because there is a whole song that's like, I'll never be unhappy again now that I have love. And it's like, so true.
So true, bestie.
Yeah, so true.
That is death how that works. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, it's time for our segments then. How could this movie be gayer? I open the floor.
Well, Tucker and Dale definitely, I don't think either of them is gay, actually. I think they are straight homies who kiss goodnight. Yes. Do you know what I mean? Because they also have, like, in addition to the roadhead scene in the car, there's a scene where they, like, Dale falls right on top of Tucker, which is a very rom-com-y, romance-y trope that I love. Because it's always so silly goofy, and they kind of, like, have that, too, that moment. Without... again, being like homophobic about it, which is so great. Bar is literally so low, but for a 2010 movie, it's so great.
This is one of the few movies where I'm like, if they were gay, it would like detract from the whole like thing that the movie's trying to do, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, and so I don't need it right now.
A little bit. They've got the whole like needy Jennifer thing going on where one friend is undercutting the other friend a little bit so that they can be the top bitch. But that aside, it's not homoerotic between them. Other than the way where sometimes it's a little romantic with your friends, it's just not erotic for them with their friends, you know?
Some of the college kids could be gay.
In fact, there's like four, the ratio of boys to girls on that trip to me implies that there's a lot of gay activity going on.
Just saying.
They've got three college, girls and like six guys.
They're experimenting.
Some of those guys are kissing each other.
I mean, statistically, yeah.
Statistically.
Okay, well, then that brings us to where would Matthew Lillard fit into this film?
I have the perfect place for Matthew Lillard, and I want him to be the hillbilly gas attendant at the beginning of the film.
Perfect.
Who's reading the inventory list and
in
sells
the cute
the
little
pickled
overalls.
Oh,
look at the overalls.
Right?
That would be great. I love that for him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if we're doing time traveling, then I would love to have him be one of the... he'd be a great Chad. He'd be a great Chad.
I think he'd be a great Mitchell.
Yeah.
The one who impales himself on the
Mitchell.
Tree.
Mm-hmm. I can see him in a shirt that's got a name tag on it.
He could be the one who dove into the wood chipper.
Oh, he's so tall and lanky, though. I feel like his arms would get, well, maybe you get sucked in a little bit. I'm not really sure how wood chippers work. But
I still want to be able to see his face. So I don't like that one, but I respect you.
Is there a way for him to slip feet first into the wood chipper? Maybe he's doing a karate kick and
he's like folded in half.
Right.
Yeah.
Changes everything
and
for me.
I mean, like, you know, then they're maybe fighting his arms or something instead of holding his legs. But he's just screaming the whole time because his lower half is getting wood chippered.
So I love that.
He still can't explain that it was just a oopsie goopsie.
Yeah. By God. We love it. We'd love to see him die gruesomely in a hilarious way.
He would be great at it.
He's great at that.
So many options
okay.
for him, too.
Really, truly. Well, that brings us to the dumb bitch. And it's Chad.
Yeah, I mean, there's really just no other option here. Like, you could give it to some of the other college kids who die sooner in the misunderstanding. Like, Mitchell is a little bit of a dumb bitch because he's running without anyone really chasing him. But you can understand why he thinks someone's chasing him. Yeah, like, you know, you can understand why everybody else is being a dumb bitch.
Yeah,
they're working with the information
like,
they have. Chad is going above and beyond.
Yeah, and Chad is, like, feeding the narrative hardcore, you know.
Chad is like, what if we went to this scene of my parents' murder for a fun time out in the wilderness, and I'm going to tell everybody about my parents' murder. I'm not going to mention it's my parents' murder, because I don't want the vibe to get weird, but I am going to bring it up, because I'm here and I need to talk about it.
Don't be weird, bro.
Don't be weird, bro. Don't be weird.
Oh, my God. Don't be weird. Don't be weird about it, but my whole family was massacred here. I'm so sorry. I said don't be weird.
You guys are really bringing down the vibe.
I've literally had exactly that happen to me. Someone was like, don't be weird, but here's something horrible that happened to me. And then I said, I'm so sorry. And then they said, I said don't be weird. And I was like, okay, well, I didn't know what other option there was.
I wasn't
to respond
sure what
to that.
Was the non-weird option.
It's just silence.
If you
so
could
not say anything,
feed,
I just say,
feed me a line, maybe. Tell me what you would like me to say beforehand,
yeah,
and I'll just keep it in mind while you give me the story.
Very uncomfortable time. Anyway, okay, it's Chad. Chad's a dumb bitch.
Chad's a dumb bitch, for sure, for sure, for sure.
Yeah.
You know who's not a dumb bitch?
Who?
Dale, for a variety of reasons. I mean, he's obviously very smart. But also, per IMDb trivia, he is, like, one of the only people in movies who's using a nail gun as a weapon, who's using it properly, which is to say it's hooked up to an air compressor so that it can fire the nails. And he's, like, has his fingers on this safety tip on part of it, which it won't fire if you're not. So he's using good workplace safety to fire that nail gun.
Damn.
That's called a blue-collared boy, baby.
He's a man who knows his way around a nail gun. That's a terrifying weapon, by the way.
Sure. I mean, yeah.
Another Final Destination reference.
True. Just oh my god. And that is Final Destination 3.
Well, it all goes back to Final Destination 3. It the best does. Final Destination.
It always does.
Okay, now it's time for Knives Out of Fives.
Yeah. So this movie was well received. I have heard of it, I think, but like clearly it wasn't such a huge splash that it's one of the big names everybody talks about, although more people should, of course. But people did like it. It has a 7.5 out of 10 on IMDb. And then on Rotten Tomatoes, it is 85% fresh from critics and 85% fresh from audiences, which is pretty good. Pretty impressive stuff.
Yeah, that's great. I mean, I think this movie is so fun. It like really flew under the radar for me up until like, again, like 2 years ago, but it's all up on Netflix. So you see it all the time when you're in the horror section, as I am often. But yeah, it's just like a joy. I don't know. I don't like have a ton of crazy thoughts about it, but like I had a really fucking good time and I wouldn't change anything unless the end is that guy dragging a woman out to kill her. But we don't know that for sure. And it might be fine. Yeah.
I think it was an accident. He was trying to help.
Yeah. I mean,
I choose to believe.
I don't know. I want to give it like a 5 out of 5 because it's just like joy. It's just like joy. It's not like it's like better than the other movies that we've done. That it's not better than The Exorcist, which I gave less than a 5 out of 5. But it's just.
But you don't have to use your brain.
Knives Out of Fives are not always about how good the movie is or how much you liked it. It is some special combination that is also vibes of the evening.
It also depends on like where the moon is and the sky and the
it's
time
a
of
one
day.
Time how many Knives Out of Fives had. In this moment only. Ask me any other time, who knows what knives I would give.
Who knows?
Exactly.
Who knows?
It could change on a dime.
It's arbitrary completely. 5 out of 5 knives.
Honestly, right there with you. This movie is so good. It holds up. Like it, and because I refuse to believe that he's doing that on purpose at the end. So this movie is an unproblematic fave. Like,
sorry,
this movie's
for
just
that
so
darkness.
Good. And here's the thing: this movie's really fun to watch in like a group, like with like a big group.
Yeah, that would be really fun. Movie night.
Yeah. Movie night. You've got your setup now.
Oh, yeah. I'm very excited. Unveiling the summer spookies. I have an outdoor movie spooky scenario where I can watch it outside on a projector.
Gorgina.
Anyway, I'm going to watch every single spooky movie on that. Continue. Sorry, I'm excited.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to bring down the vibe because I also think this is a 5 out of 5 knives for fun. But I do a little bit hate the Chad backstory reveal. So I feel like I would dock, not many, because again, I otherwise think it's great and I think it's a lot of fun. And I think Dale is such a cutie patootie. And I'm rooting for him and Allison and I hope they work it out and they get married and they spend their lives together. But I would dock like 0.2 points. So like, I'll give it like a 4.8 knives out of fives.
Respectable.
Okay. Hey, that's still really good.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing. Well, I hope you enjoyed having fun and laughing and doing a little giggle and being like, oh, they're in love. Oh, how sweet. Because from what I
hear
about
now.
Yeah, it's over now. From what I hear about this next movie, like, I've heard so many positive reviews about this movie being like, it is so great. It is so amazing. Blah, blah, blah. I love the movies that they're based off of. Those are a joy and a laugh and a hoot and a holler. But apparently in 2013, we did a dark and sinister rebrand of the Evil Dead franchise. So we've got Evil Dead Rise. It's just come out. Everybody's talking about it. They're buzzing about it. It also looks fucked up. Before I can go see that movie, I gotta watch Evil Dead 2013. So we're doing that next week. and I've heard words to use to describe it that I can't repeat now because I don't remember them, but I remember when I read them.
But
I was
they were
disturbed.
Upsetting. Yeah.
They were disturbing.
Boy,
words.
Boy, are they words.
Yeah. They are words. I feel like I'm worried that there's going to be like a little Hills Have Eyes kind of.
Yeah. Well, energy. There was that moment in the original Evil Dead too with the trees and the girl outside with the trees.
Yes.
So really a lot of potential for things
I wasn't
to be
necessarily, thinking of like that aspect of it. I hope that there's no R words happening in this movie. I just think the gore is going to be on that. On that level that we don't usually go to here at Spooky Tuesday, but we are capable of multitudes and maybe it'll be fine.
Maybe it'll be fun. Maybe Jay Levy did like a fun, silly, scary movie instead of like a fucked up, scary movie.
Okay, well, I'll say this again next week, but my friend Paul told me that Diablo Cody did some like uncredited rewrites for this movie to make it funny. So there is humor in it, which there should be because it's an Evil Dead
Evil
movie.
Dead.
Sure. It doesn't have to be funny.
Well,
they're
then
not going to
give
me Bruce, and it's got to have a little joke. So anyway, hold our hand next week, y'all, because we're doing Evil Dead 2013, and I'm scared. And you know what? How are you going to hold our hands? You can't come here to my house. Please don't. But you can write me a 5-star review. Write a 5-star review and say...
Psychologically, you could hold our hand.
Yeah, you could say, I'm here for you, and you're going to make it through Evil Dead 2013 with a little heart, or you could do the handhold emoji and it'll feel just like you're there with us getting us through it. Consider it. Sounds like a really nice, sweet thing. And also, why not follow us on social media? We're at Spooky_Tuesday on TikTok, Twitter, and Instagram. We're also that on YouTube. We're still trying to get to 100 subscribers. It's wild over there. Episodes upon episodes coming out every other day. You wouldn't believe it. It's the same ones you've already heard though, but in a new format.
They could be new to you.
They could be new to you. You would
maybe
probably
you didn't
listen to season one.
Yeah, maybe you need to circle back and you've been like, it's so hard to scroll to the beginning of Apple Podcasts. Well, guess what? You just have to go on YouTube and they'll give you a new one each time.
It's amazing. It's amazing. You'll love it so much. So subscribe. And also, we are at Spooky Tuesday Pod on Facebook. Shout out to our Facebook people that I talk to all day, every day.
Leo. We love you.
And also, we are on Letterboxd at Spooky Tuesday, doing reviews all the time. So thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you next Tuesday.
Bye, spookies.
Oh, I never thought I'd say this, but I'm glad I'm not hung like a bear.
Spooky Tuesday was created by Monica Height, Sydney Thompson, and Chelsea Duff, and edited by Sydney Thompson. Our gorgeously spooky tunes are all thanks to Tamra Simons, who you can follow on Instagram at Captain Tamra, and our podcast art is by Mary Murphy, who you can find on Instagram at the_moon_OMG.